My name is Carl Kerner. I'm the chair of the Queensborough Public Library. I'd like to take a minute to introduce my colleagues on the board. I'd like to introduce them in alphabetical order so that none of them will criticize me later, even though they've chosen not to sit in alphabetical order. Adrian is not here yet, though, right? No, so Adrian Adams will be joining us later. Honorable Augustus Agati. Judy Bertram, who's vice chair of the board. Maria Concolino. Lenora Gall. Matthew Gorton is not here yet, right? No, Matt will be joining us later. Julissa Gutierrez, James Haddad, Juke Zhu, Hayden Miltolces, Michael Rodriguez, who's our treasurer. Edward Sadowski is unable to join us today. Ellie Shapiro, Earl Simons, oh, he's here. He's our assistant treasurer. Gabriel Tausig. And two other trustees who were not able to join us, Robert Santos, I just want to acknowledge them, and Martha Baker. Also, we're...
Can you go through the names one more time? I don't know about everybody else. I didn't get the names too easily.
Yeah, we have a printout with the names of the Board of Trustees in addition.
Is that on the webpage?
Yes, our names are on the webpage.
No, the printout on PDF.
Good, great, thank you. In addition, on our Board of Trustees, we're privileged to have our elected officials, and they serve through their representatives. Is light in here?
Yeah.
Where are you?
I'm coming.
Oh, he's walking in as we speak. Light and Sleeper O'Connell, who is here representing Mayor de Blasio. Public Advocate Letitia James is on our board. Her representative, unfortunately, was unable to attend. Delaine Fahn, who is here representing Controller Scott Stringer. She'll come up and join us, Elaine. Eva Cho Gilligan, who is representing Speaker Melissa Mark Vivarito. Elisa Velasquez, who is here representing Borough President Melinda Katz. And seated to my right is our interim president and CEO, Bridget Quinn Carey. I would like to thank our elected representatives who will be greeting you in a few moments. I don't know if they've arrived yet. Council Majority Leader Jimmy Von Bramer. I don't think he's here yet. And Council Member Rory Lanceman. I'd also like to welcome our colleagues in District 37, District Council 37. And especially Communications Director Chris Policano. Is he here?
Not yet.
Great, okay. The members of the Board of Trustees are entrusted with overseeing the operations of the Queens Library and making sure that it's operated in the best interest of the people of Queens. Our goal in having this hearing tonight is to create a transparent budget process. To start a conversation about what the community needs and wants from its library, and to establish a vehicle through which the board reports to the community on how we spend the public funds. To start the proceedings, I'd like to introduce our interim president and CEO, Bridget Quinn Carey.
Thank you, Carl. This evening will be a continuation of a conversation that I hope, and that the board hopes, will help make Queens Library even more impactful in people's lives. Queens Library is our library, but it really is your library. It is one of the best loved and best used educational organizations in the borough. And we hope that by gathering your input, we can make it even more responsive and more valuable to you. 2 years ago, Queens Library began a very intensive strategic planning process. We did many focus groups and surveys to gather input from the public and spoke with literally hundreds of people. This is another step in that process. It's an opportunity for the community to give their feedback, which we can then use to shape priorities going forward. Through your participation, we will make Queens Library more robust and more transparent. To begin, we have some special guests tonight, and I want to thank them for being here. if they are here, but I think we're gonna wait on that and we'll welcome them as they come. Let's see. I think there are some representatives from our community boards here today. If so, yes, wonderful. Thank you so much for being here and being a part of this process. We really value your input and know how important community boards are to the fabric of life here in Queens, and they're so important to what we do at the Queens Library as well. And I would also like to acknowledge and thank our Board of Trustees. They are all volunteers, and they have spent many, 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 many countless hours working on behalf of the library, on behalf of you and the people that they represent, to help make sure that the library runs smoothly and is governed effectively. Each month, they attend meetings, they go on library visits, they pore over reports, they come and contribute and ask important questions, they talk to elected officials. They really are working on your behalf tirelessly, and I think it's a labor of love. So I want to thank them for all of the work that they do on behalf of the library. And Carl mentioned it, but I also want to thank our colleagues from DC 37 and Local 1321. I see John Heislip is here. Thank you, John, for joining us tonight. And the entire staff of the Queens Library. Without you, and those so many of you are here tonight, thank you. Without you, this would not be the place that it is. You make it special, and it's your contributions on a day-to-day basis that make the Queens Library the amazing library that it is. So before we turn it over to you, I want to say a few words about the process tonight. First, we have asked speakers to please sign up. So if you would like to speak and haven't yet signed up to speak, please do so now. There's a table in the hallway and we'll give you a number. When you sign up, we'll give you that number, and then when it's time for those numbers, we'll call everybody up to the microphones. And in order to permit everybody to speak, we will limit your time to about 3 minutes, although if there aren't that many speakers, we may extend that. But generally, everybody will have 3 minutes. If there's more that you'd like to tell us, there will be an opportunity for you. We do now have live on our site a feedback form, so you can write to us. If something comes to you today that you haven't, or tomorrow or the next day, think about sharing it with us today, there will be an opportunity for you to do that and share that. There's a feedback form at queenslibrary.org/budgetfeedback. There's also a form in the packet that you received this evening. So comments will be taken until April 30th, and then we will compile the results and report back to you through the media and on the library's website. You received a handout today, and if you haven't, we've got them outside, that shows the library's sources of revenue and expenses for fiscal year 15, and that's the current year that we're in. It also has what the library is proposing for the next fiscal year, which is fiscal year 16, and that was the information that has been up on the website as well. As you probably know, we are funded approximately 87% by the City of New York and about 6% by the State of New York. Now, neither the city nor the state, although the state is very close, have adopted a final budget where we actually have the confirmed numbers for our budgets yet. So in reality, we don't know how much we will be getting to be able to spend for next fiscal year. What you have in your documents is a budget. It's a proposed budget. It's our best guess for what we think we will receive at a minimum and how we propose to spend those funds. The reality when we get our funding may be very different. We hope that it is. We hope that we receive quite a bit more, but we won't know that from the city's perspective until June, and from the state it may be another few days before we're exactly sure what that allocation is. And Queens Library, along with Brooklyn Library and the New York Public Library and DC 37, have requested additional funding of $65 million for the library systems for next fiscal year. That would enable Queens Library to open all of our libraries 6 days a week. We know already from feedback from many of you that is something that you're very interested in, because right now 42 of our libraries are closed. They do not have any weekend service. And we know that you want library services on the weekends, you want more hours during the week, and you want programs and services during that time that are important to you and to your families, whether that's to take a workshop, a class, take English classes, use the computer, borrow a mobile hotspot, take your child or your grandchild to a story time. These are the kinds of things we know you want access to, and we're interested in hearing from you today what those kinds of things are. I hope you'll help us in this advocacy effort. There are petitions outside and where you can sign to tell the mayor and the city council how important library services are to you. So I would appreciate it if you'd make it a point to do that on your way out to help advocate for increased funding for your libraries. But our main purpose tonight is to hear from you. So we'll start that part of our process. So the speakers that have numbers 1 through 6, will you please make your way to see either Larry or Joanne, and we will get this process started. Thank you so much.
Can you hear? Oh, okay. Sorry. It's okay. Good evening. My name is Arlene Abdalian, president of the Friends of the Douglaston Little Neck Library. On behalf of the Friends Group, I'm here today to thank you all for everything you've done and are doing to secure funding for 6 days service and the 10-year capital plan. That's because we rely on the Queen's Library every day to provide access to free books and materials, free after-school programs for our kids, free computers, free classes, and free adult education. For example, I have the necessary statistics to illustrate the need for expanded service, staff, and facility at my branch library. From July 1st, 2014 to February 28th, 2015, Douglaston Little Neck witnessed a 13% increase in visitors over the previous period, a 26% increase in attendance of our various programs, and while circulation was categorized in the middle third of all 62 branch libraries, Douglaston Little Neck also ranks in size among the 10 smallest branch libraries in the system. In fact, the current building structure measures in total 10,200 square feet, of which only its first floor of 5,700 square feet can be used for the public and staff, whereas new libraries in Queens now range in sizes much larger, averaging at around 18,000 square feet, in order to accommodate not only library visitors, but current state-of-the-art computer equipment as well. Furthermore, Douglaston Little Neck's HVAC, ceiling and lighting, security systems, audiovisual, and other facility systems are also antiquated and require updating. For example, our meeting room can only legally hold 45 people, yet our events and programs have consistently drawn standing room only crowds of 60 or more, such as our Native Americans of Little Neck film screenings and lectures, the Birds of Queens, the Waters of Queens lectures, and many others. Clearly, the existing building is too small and inadequate to support the increased utilization by our community. So we thank you for including our new facility request in the Queens Library's 10-year capital plan, but we must secure funding for not only our capital budget expense request, but those of the other branches as well. So we support the Queens Library's efforts to secure 6 days service and capital funding, and we urge everyone to write to our elected officials at www.investinlibraries.org. Thank you very much.
Good evening. I'm Dr. Wen Song Li. I come from this area, which is I represent an American Chinese tradition organization we call ACAP, which is we have 700 members and which is tradition, most of them working in this area, Queens. But due to this library gave us community support, we realized the library did a great job, for example, mail a book to the people who homebounding, but unfortunately a lot of people don't know this program. Due to this reason, and our ACAPs work with library, our ACAPs is a non-profit organization, work with library. We set up, we call community health education partnership, including multiple hospitals around and multiple organizations around in Queens area, which is great. And also we set up the lecture to the community, which is most in Flushing Library in Chinese. Also, we try to get Spanish doctor and the regular English, the talking speaker, to give the libraries and member to education about the healthy. I think education is number one, which is like everybody, and the healthy is everybody's concern. So that's why we build up community health education program. Now we face challenge. The challenge is first, then we tell our 700 member, the member say, wow, great, library support us to help the people health education. Then we set up the program, but each month, the challenge is we don't have space. The people, we already said 1 year. Every month follow American, some months, and hard months, long months, we talk about the same topic for nation concern. But like some dentists, some ophthalmology, some pediatrician come to us say, we want to talk to our and the library about this education, which is we have to schedule like next year. Okay, this is we need the library to support us community health education partnership, which is built up by two non-profit organizations, Queens Library and American Physician, Chinese Physician Association. This is one. Second one, okay, back to the paper, I review it, and I don't have too much time to review it, because my office even just 2 blocks away, but I do have quite a busy time. I'm sitting here, review it, I found this program is very, very important. I focus the program. I found the program, the percentage expense will drop 1%. So from 15 to 16, it's dropped 1%. That's a big, big number. So I like and put more program to let the community think about the healthy. Because all Americans talk about healthy reform, health system, okay, please, please consider this situation. If you and somebody like talk to me, after I will appreciate my office is 2 blocks away.
Good evening, members of the board and fellow Queens Library members. My name is Dean Hutchins, and I live near the Briarwood branch. And I'm an employee of the New York State Court System for almost 30 years. I'm a student at Pace University, and I'm also a volunteer with New York Cares. And within the last couple of months, I started having an opportunity, having some time to revisit the Briarwood branch, and I must say that I'm quite shocked at the inadequate hours that the library has been cut down to. I just remember just a while back that there were longer hours, and I've had to catch myself, I work in Manhattan, but I've had to catch myself in a lot of instances leaving my job early to actually get to the Briarwood branch before they closed. And more importantly, in terms of volunteering projects, New York Cares has asked me to step up and actually become a team leader and actually orient some projects at that branch. The branch manager is interested. Project managers at New York Cares are very interested in reorienting projects there. But the fact of the matter is, with the hours that are currently being held at the library, that is just close to impossible to do. The Saturday hours would really, really, really be able to be beneficial to the organization and to the community in general. I've had to, in fact, travel in terms of any other volunteering assignments that I've had. I've had to travel to other branches. I've had to travel to the Rockaway branch. I've had to travel to the Woodside branch. I've had to go to Brooklyn. I've had to go to every other branch except my local branch to perform what I believe are projects that are very, very beneficial to the community. So I just wanted to communicate that to the board and just let the members know and hope that that will be taken into consideration respect to the budget. Thank you.
Alex
speaking into the microphone, just in the microphones. Thank you, board members, board of trustees, and Queens Library staff for taking the time out to make the budget process open. My name is Karina. I'm the president for the Friends of Richmond Hill Library. I testified on March 20th, so yeah, I was really, that was a very nervous one. But since we're all like Queens people, you know, we can all talk. I'm really here tonight on behalf of the Friends group too, and members of my library, because most, you know, most likely people are stuck at work, to, you know, discuss like our priority is our basement. We want to reclaim our basement so that we can have what Cambria Heights has, a teen center, a massive meeting room. You know, we only have one meeting room, and unfortunately that limits the amount of programming that we can have. And you know, I was really shocked that 1 week that we had to have a tutoring session held in one of the rooms that holds snow blowers and lawnmowers, and the smell of gas is really bad in there. And that was really like a shocking experience, because I don't think any child and adult should be in that situation to see what what our basement's like behind those doors that they don't get to go into. You know, I think the basement would be an upgrade to our library. It is a massive amount of space that is underutilized. And I mean, it could make our library one of the biggest, you know, amount of, you know, whatever. Sorry, I'm like getting choked up. But I think the basement is an underutilized space, and you know, there's no reason why it has to be a storage room. And you know, I don't know. I mean, the tour that I went through and saw the amount of room space that there is, there's so much potential. I know a lot of branches are complaining about space, but our library has the potential to be a 21st century library, to have a teen center, to have a conference room, like my school does. It has a beautiful conference rooms, to have a, you know, an adult literacy center. You know, all these spaces, this space is what we want. Yeah, this is all we want, basement. Reclaiming our library and reclaiming our basement so that we can have a 21st century basement. That's all I'm gonna say. Have a good night. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Dawa Jung, and I am here to represent New York State Senator Tony Avella. This hearing marks a momentous step to ensure that our libraries are administered in an efficient and transparent manner. The inaugural public hearing is one of the pivotal aspects of the Queens Library reform that Senator Avella fought so hard for. While he could not be here due to the ongoing budget negotiation in Albany, he is very proud and thrilled to see his and all of your hard work and efforts come to fruition this evening. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Kevin Burns, and I only represent myself. I'm a very happy and grateful user of the Queens Library system, and I think it is important that everyone understand that although the branch libraries are world-based, the system offers so much, and I love the central library. I love coming into this building. But my home library is Richmond Hill, and I will second a lot of what was just said about Richmond Hill, but from my perspective, I moved from Glendale to Leverett's Boulevard a year ago. I was so happy when I found out that two blocks from my house was this public library called Richmond Hill. You know, I had a little trouble getting around. And while I can make trips to Central Library, I think the branch libraries are important for people who may have mobility issues. So the branch libraries maybe need a boost. Richmond Hill is a Carnegie Hill building, and beautiful, all of those Carnegie Hill buildings. But they offer challenges of space and serving a growing public. What was said about this lower floor is true. We would probably appreciate having funding to make that lower basement accessible to the public, serving the public in various ways. When I lived in Glendale, I saw what a good basement really can do for the public. And boy, Glendale was beautiful, and Richmond Hill can be the same without doing too much to the building itself. I only have three requests or suggestions. 6 days, yes. I spent the whole day at the library today. It opened up with a crowd outside the front door. people are returning and picking up all the way through. Students arrived around 2:45 in hordes. The place was jumping. That's great. Around 4 o'clock I left, I saw people online, kids with tons of books and DVDs and a whole bunch of stuff, and then parents picking up stuff. I saw people picking up test manuals, and that an unemployed man just wanted to use the newspapers each day to stay informed. And it serves a growing and diverse population, as well through all the branch libraries. A 6-day operation would ease up some of the stress, and there is stress I saw on the staff and the general public. I have trouble sometimes getting to computers. There are only 5 at Richmond Hill. You're restricted to a half hour. I can barely load up on that time, and then if I have printing problems, it's an issue. So in addition to 6 days, I'm suggesting more computers in the branch libraries. And lastly is, I suggest that redoing the basement, reclaiming the basement, and using that to serve the various needs of Richmond Hill would go very, very far. So I respectfully request those. And maybe a specialist at converting Carnegie Hill type buildings, because I think there are special needs there and special opportunities without destroying them. And last but not least, I'm in my 7th decade. Anyone on the board there that's young, remember you were told to listen to your elders. So, suggestion, thank you very, very much for all you do.
I wasn't going to speak, but I guess I will since I'm here. My name is Douglas Montgomery. I'm chair of Community Board 11 Libraries Committee. I'm also chair of fundraising effort for a buy-a-book program at the Queen's Douglas Library. I mean, I was appalled last year when I found out our budget for books in the library was $4,300. We have since been able to raise over $6,000 for the buy-a-book program. On another effort, I will tell you, Arlene Abdalian is amazing. She runs an amazing series of programs. She came to you guys for an estimate to get our meeting room done, and you gave her a figure of around $95,000. We got it put into the participatory budget through Paul Falones, and then we were told that it's $221,000. Okay? It almost ruined our chances at money. You have to be more consistent with the people that are running these libraries.
Good evening. My name is John Desereaux, and I was not planning on speaking, but I think I have something to share, and it's kind of from the other side. I am the Community Business Relations Manager for Barnes & Noble in Forest Hills, and we, like the library, have had some setbacks. We recently closed the branch next to St. John's. One of the programs that my company offers, and which I am responsible for at this local level, is fundraising opportunities for nonprofits, literacy partners. So at the risk of possibly coming across as inappropriate, but in a genuine sense, we do offer revenue share opportunities in the way that we also offer holiday book drives. We had customers given the opportunity to purchase books December of last year to support the 4 branches in the Rockaways that were destroyed, and we literally donated thousands of books on behalf of our customers. I just want the board and the other potential literacy partners here to be aware that we can have dialogue. We are for-profit, you are not-for-profit. That has been somewhat difficult, but we are all here for the greater good of literacy of our community, and I'm open to suggestion and dialogue with anyone. Thank you very much.
My name is John Hislop, and I'm the president of Local 1321, Queens Library Guild, representing the Queens Library workers. I don't have any a comment on the budget. I am happy that this is becoming a more transparent process. This is the first time we've done this, the library's done this, and it's a start, it's a good start. What I'm here to say to everybody is that DC-37 and the 3 systems are working together to fight for the $65 million. So we can get this 6-day service so we can hire more people. So it's up to us in this room to advocate with the mayor's office and the city council to let them know that we need this money. Because the $65 million will hire more people and have six-day service. So that's my comment.
My name is Rosalie Quinones. I'm the vice president of the Friends of the Briarwood Library. We were just chartered in October, and we're really trying to get the community to get into more programs and more activities at Briarwood. I'm also an educator, too. I worked for 25 years as an educator and an assistant principal in a high school. Sometimes we forget when we're in our comfort zone and our careers and we're working, that there are other families out there that don't have computers at home. Kids that don't even know what a computer is unless if they go to a library or a school and experience what technology is. I mean, we're behind in the school system as far as getting kids up to par with what the technology is out there. But the libraries are falling behind too. And it's a shame. We're living in the USA. I mean, when we look outside and we see that we're supposed to be so high tech, we're not. And the libraries are falling behind just like the school system is. I think we need to band together and work more together and volunteer as much as we can. That's what we're trying to see more in Briarwood as well. And I wasn't going to talk, but I just felt I had to say something. Thank you.
Hi, we're just, we're hopeful that our elected officials are going to join us, so we're checking to see where they are en route. And if not, we will say thank you and good night, but if you could give us just a couple minutes, because I know how important this process has been to our elected officials, as the library and the trustees and our staff have really made an effort this year to put out information about the budget much earlier than usual and to solicit feedback, and that is something that the elected officials we know find important, and we would hope that they would be here to speak about that as well. So,
my name is Claire Gosnett, and we live about a block and a half from here, so I spend a lot of time in the library. Most of my time is spent at the senior center, about 4 or 5 days a week. But anyway, I felt I had to come. I have to run. I'm with an the Oratorio Society of Queens, and we have a practice in a half hour. But anyway, I felt I needed to stop in, and I picked up a form, and I filled it out, and I told everybody what I think, but I know everybody here has different things that they want and they need in their libraries, because the libraries aren't all the same. Some are very large and have a lot of stuff, and some don't. So we have to all speak up and fill out the forms and get them in so that people can see what we need and what we want at the different libraries. And anyway, so that's all I wanted to say, and I hope the people that come will be able to help us get the money to get all of the branches, no matter where they are in Queens, doing what they're supposed to be doing, educating and getting people moving and getting Queens moving. So, thank you.
Hello, it's Arlene Abdalian once again from the Douglas and Little Neck Friends Group. I just want to say one thing, that I'm going through withdrawal right now. I had to return to the Flushing Library my mobile hotspot. I'm one of those people, after having it since December, 3 renewals, and was told that there are none available here, so I'm going to have to try to see if there's one available at Central Library or some other branch. I was told by one of the librarians there are only 500 devices of this type. I'm one of those people who can't afford the extortionist prices of the telecoms. I do not have internet access at home. So the mobile hotspot program is vital to people like me and many, many others. As one of the librarians told me, there are 500 in the system, and there's almost close to a million users of the Queens Library. It's absolutely vital. I'm very happy that we went to Albany and made the case for the mobile hotspot program to our state legislators. I'm even more happy, I'm happier to report that I had a follow-up meeting with my state assembly member, Ed Bronstein, who signed up on to the letter and who is going to do all he can to get more money for the mobile hotspot program. But I can't tell you what it's like for me now. I'm going to go home and I'm not going to be able to get online. So I just wanted you to know how grateful someone like me is to the Queens Library for having this kind of program. And hopefully I'll have one soon again. Bye.
My name is Matt Gordon. I'm one of the trustees. Mr. Burns, is that... So the Glendale branch is my home branch. And I think one of the things you said is that you do have these beautiful branches, the Carnegie branches. And as we move 21st century, how to adapt those structures, which are beautiful, to the needs of what we have today. I remember when I'm going to the Glendale branch, they used to have book sales in the basement. And the book, so you could borrow the books on the first floor, and then they had the loft area. And they would have book sales in the basement. I always went because I wanted to borrow something. As I've gotten older, I appreciate more and more the physical structure of the library. I didn't even realize it. This like exposed beams in the Glendale branch. But one of the challenges I think we face is with capital dollars that we get from the city, how can we best utilize them? And also realizing that there are assets within our libraries like the basement floor that at least when I was going to the library when I was in school, wasn't really utilized. So the ideas that you're bringing to us about their space here, we could use that, what about this idea here, it's really, really helpful because some of the things that we're trying to get more capital money, trying to best utilize our space, that's helpful. So I just want to thank you for your compliment. Or not compliment, I want to thank you for your suggestion.
Well, our special invited guests do send their best to you and to us, but realize that you may have other things that you would like to do this evening. So I want to, on behalf of the trustees and the staff, I want to thank you for coming, and I want to thank our community board folks, our friends at the library, all the volunteers that have come here today, and just our users and community residents for coming and sharing your thoughts with us. We will be doing this every year, so we look forward to hearing from you again. And please also remember there is the online comment form. If you do think of something else you would like to share with us, you have until April 30th to do that. It is on our website. Thank you very much for being here with us this evening, and have a very nice evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.